Good evening and welcome to tonight's meeting of the Commonwealth Club of California, the place where you are in the know. You can find the club on the internet at commonwealthclub.org. I'm Mary Cranston, past chair of the Commonwealth Club's Board of Governors and senior partner at the law firm of Pillsbury, Winthrop, Shaw, Pittman, and your moderator for tonight's program. Tonight's program is part of the Charles and Louise Travers series on ethics and accountability. In May 2009, the Financial Crisis Inquiry Commission was created by Congress and authorized by President Obama to examine the causes, domestic and global, of the financial and economic crisis in the United States. This independent 10-member panel was composed of private citizens with experience in areas such as housing, economics, finance, market regulation, banking, and consumer protection. Six members of the commission were appointed by the Democratic leaders in the Congress and four by the Republican leadership. In the course of its research and investigation, the commission reviewed millions of pages of documents, interviewed more than 700 witnesses, and held 19 days of public hearings in New York, Washington, D.C., and communities across the country that were hard hit by the crisis. On January 27th of this year, the Commission delivered its report to the President, Congress, and to the American people. The Commission concluded that the financial crisis was avoidable. It found widespread failure in regulation, dramatic breakdowns in corporate governance, excessive borrowing and risk-taking by households and Wall Street, policymakers who were ill-prepared for the crisis, and systematic breaches in accountability and ethics at all levels. The report was not without controversy, as two separate dissents were also submitted, one by three Republican appointees and another by the fourth Republican. One dissent points to broad economic forces that contributed to the credit and housing bubbles that built up during the last decade, including a glut of savings in developing Asian countries that provided the fuel for mortgage-backed investments in the United States and Europe. It does not focus on the culpability of government and business leaders, as the main report does. The second dissent argues that government housing policies fostered the housing bubble and the creation of 27 million subprime loans. The dissents reject as too simplistic the hypothesis that too little regulation caused the crisis. So against this backdrop, it is my very great pleasure to introduce tonight's distinguished guest, Phil Angelides, chair of the Obama administration's Financial Crisis Inquiry Commission and former California State Treasurer, who is here to give his perspective on the commission's report and its ramifications. Mr. Angelides is currently president of the Review Capital Investments Company, which focuses on sustainable urban development and clean energy projects. As I mentioned, from 1999 to 2007, he was California's state treasurer. The Associated Press reported that he made the sleepy treasurer's office a policy powerhouse. And the Sacramento Bee praised Treasurer Angelides as the most effective and dynamic state treasurer in a generation. Mr. Angelides is a graduate of Harvard and was a Coro Foundation Fellow. So please welcome Phil Angelides.
Thank you so much. Thank you very much. Thank you, Mary, for that gracious introduction, and thank you for the great summary of the report. I'll now take questions. I want to thank the Commonwealth Club for all you do, and I want to thank the Travers family for sponsoring this series on ethics and accountability in our society. Before I begin tonight, I'd like to start with a couple of acknowledgments. The first is I'd like to introduce and acknowledge my wife, who is here tonight, Julie Angelides, who helps me be engaged in civic and political life for our country and our state. So thank you very much for what my wife does. I want to start first by a special acknowledgement. Almost 2 years ago, Speaker Nancy Pelosi spoke here at the Commonwealth Club, and she called for the creation of a commission to investigate the meltdown in our financial markets that sent our nation's economy into a tailspin. She said at the time, quote, "We need to know," close quote, "what happened on Wall Street." And so after the Fraud Recovery and Enforcement Act was signed by the President that created the Financial Crisis Inquiry Commission, I was honored that the Speaker appointed me to serve. And I thank her for that privilege, but I also want to thank her tonight for her courageous efforts last year to pass financial reform legislation in the face of ferocious opposition by powerful and moneyed interests. I want to thank the Bay Area. for sending our way two terrific commissioners. The first is John Thompson. He's the chairman and the former CEO of Symantec, the Fortune 500 technology company based in Mountain View. He was a terrific and dedicated commissioner. And I want to thank you also for a San Francisco native, Brooksley-born, who grew up in this town, who went to Stanford Law School, and is as head of the Commodities Future Trading Commission in the 1990s, courageously tried to regulate the derivatives market, and for that earned the John F. Kennedy Profiles in Courage Award. And she was a phenomenal commissioner, and it was a pleasure to get to know and work with both these fine people. I also want to acknowledge two people who are in the audience tonight who are part of a very dedicated team that had an enormous mission. We are joined tonight by Chris Seifer, who is our Director of Investigations. He didn't start in that position, but he rose to it very quickly. He came in every morning at 7 in the morning, left at 1 a.m., except near the end when we left around 3 or 4 in the morning. He did a terrific job, always straightforward, always fair, always looking for the truth. He's here tonight, and also joining him was his right hand, a great member of our investigative team, Ms. Clara Moraine, and I want to ask you to thank them for their phenomenal low-pay efforts on behalf of the United States of America. They are here. Chris, Clara, would you please? And I want to, before I begin my formal remarks, I'd like to make just a couple of personal observations. For the last 30 years, I'd spent my life in both the public and the private sector in the world of finance and real estate and investment. I thought I had some reasonable understanding of this nation's financial system. And I will tell you that for me and my fellow commissioners, this was a journey of revelation. Along the way, as we learned more and more every day, we were fascinated, surprised, and disturbed at what we were finding out. At times, I felt like I'd walked into a bank, opened a secret door, and seen a casino floor as big as New York, New York. And unlike, I will say, Claude Rains in Casablanca, I truly was shocked at the amount of gambling that was going on Wall Street. I also, on a more serious note, want to note that along this investigative journey, we met people from all walks of life across this country whose aspirations have been crushed by this crisis. I was deeply affected by the devastation I saw in families and communities and neighborhoods across this country. And I kept these people in mind as I did my work, hoping that in our lifetime we will never again have to have an investigative commission like this one. The financial and economic upheaval which our commission was called upon to investigate was of no small consequence to this country. The cataclysm we've experienced will likely impact our economy and our nation for a generation. It's wreaked havoc among businesses, entire communities, and families. As we meet tonight, nearly 26 million Americans are out of work, can't find full-time work, or have stopped looking for work. $11 trillion in household wealth and retirement savings have been wiped away, vanished like some day trade gone bad. 4 million families have lost their homes to foreclosure. The estimates are that that will rise to 8 to 13 million people. Many innocent bystanders, people who followed all the rules, now fear for their economic future, while our nation faces no easy path to economic recovery. I will say that there are some on Wall Street and in Washington with a big stake in the status quo who may be tempted to wipe from memory the events of this crisis or to suggest that no one could have foreseen them or nothing could have been done to prevent what occurred. I believe that our commission's report exposes facts, identifies responsibility, unravels myths, and helps us understand how this crisis could have been avoided. It was our best attempt to record history, not to rewrite it, nor to allow it ever to be rewritten. Tonight, I want to briefly describe and talk about three things. First of all, our inquiry. Secondly, discuss the conclusions we reached. And then finally, talk about where we go from here. As Mary mentioned, in 2009, we were charged with examining, quote, the causes of the current financial and economic crisis in the United States, close quote. To probe the collapse of the major financial institutions that collapsed or would have collapsed, but for the extraordinary assistance accorded by the taxpayers of this country, and to report our findings to the President, the Congress, and the American people. We were also directed, even though we were not formed as a prosecutorial entity, we were directed by law to refer to the appropriate law enforcement authorities, the Attorney General of the United States and state attorney generals, any potential violations of laws that we found. And where the commission did find such potential violations, we referred those matters and that information to the appropriate authorities. Our essential task was to determine what happened and how it happened so we could understand why it happened. And our report and our conclusions are based on this exhaustive and fact-based investigation which Mary described to you. Over the course of more than a year, we reviewed millions of pages of documents, many of which had never been seen before from financial corporations and from regulators. We interviewed more than 700 witnesses. We held 19 days of public hearings across this country. We also drew on a large body of work by other investigative bodies like the Senate Subcommittee on Permanent Investigations, other legal investigators, and academic work that had been done on the subject. Now, over the past 2 years, since the meltdown of our financial markets in the fall of 2008, there's been no shortage of debate about the government's decision to wade in and provide massive financial assistance to the financial system and to financial corporations in this country that were deemed too big or too important to fail. But our mission in this commission was to ask and answer this central question. How did it come to pass that in 2008, our nation was forced to choose between two stark and painful alternatives? Either risk the total collapse of our financial system or inject trillions of dollars of taxpayers' dollars into the system and into private companies, even as millions of Americans still lost their jobs, their savings, and their homes. As Mary said, our commission, after studying all the facts, after our intensive investigation and research, came to six major conclusions. First and foremost, we concluded that this financial crisis was avoidable. It was the result of human action, inaction, and misjudgments, not of Mother Nature, not of a computer model gone haywire. Clearly, the public stewards of our financial system failed us, and the CEOs of the financial institutions drove their companies over the cliff and our economy with it. Let's be clear, theirs was a big miss, not a stumble. And despite the expressed view of many in the power circle of financial and political power that this crisis could not have been foreseen, there were many warning signs. The tragedy is they were ignored or discounted. The red flags, the warning signs were all along the road. The unsustainable rise in house prices, the widespread reports of egregious and predatory lending practices, warnings from the FBI starting in 2004 about a pandemic of mortgage fraud, the growth in risky trading practices, the explosion in the unregulated derivatives markets, the creation of $13 trillion of mortgage securities, and I might add, since the fall of 2006, when the housing market was in decline, Wall Street created another over $1.6 trillion in mortgage securities. These were all facts and evidence. As Richard Breeden, who was the chairman of the Securities and Exchange Commission under the first President Bush, said, "This didn't happen on Pluto and Mars. You don't create trillions of dollars of mortgages without anyone noticing it. The regulators fell down on their job." Probably the best example of failure was what happened at the Federal Reserve. Starting in the late 1990s, the Federal Reserve had plenty of information about out-of-control subprime lending. Those accelerated all through the early part of the decade. In 2001, the Federal Reserve passed rules that they thought would stem the problem. As it turns out, those rules only affected 1% of subprime loans. It wasn't until 2006 that they even put forward voluntary guidance. And they didn't put down rules to stop the madness until July 2008 to require that you can't make a loan unless a borrower can repay it until July 2008 when the horse was out of the barn and we were heading towards total collapse. Alan Greenspan told us that what we needed was not more regulation but more law enforcement. But from 2000 to 2006, the Federal Reserve referred just three unfair mortgage lending cases to the Department of Justice. A little bank in Centerville, Illinois, a little bank in Palm Desert, and the New York branch of Societe Generale. None of what happened was an act of God. And the greatest tragedy coming out of this crisis would be to accept the idea that no one could have seen this crisis coming, and then thus nothing could have been done. If we accept this notion, I guarantee you it will happen again. Second, we found widespread failures in financial regulation that proved devastating to the stability of the nation's financial markets. 30 years of deregulation championed by Alan Greenspan and others, and pushed at every turn by a very powerful financial industry, had weakened the public bulwarks of protection. It's clear the sentries were not at their posts. And if you read the report, and I hope you will see many instances. There was plenty of power that our regulators had. The SEC could have contained risk at the investment banks. They did not. The Federal Reserve Bank of New York, headed by Tim Geithner at the time, could have reined in the excesses of Citigroup. They did not. Regulators could have stopped the runaway mortgage securitization train. They did not. Third, our report describes dramatic breakdowns in corporate governance and risk management at many systemically important financial institutions. You will read, as you look at our report, of grotesque and terrible failures at some of the biggest financial institutions to which we rode to the rescue. You'll read about how at AIG, the company entered into $79 billion of credit default swaps, essentially protection which they offered to people who held subprime mortgage securities. And you'll read about how the CEO, the CFO, the chief risk officer, every major official of that company did not even know the terms of those agreements. And so when firms like Goldman Sachs and others came calling and demanding cash under the terms of those agreements, they were caught off guard and shocked. Ultimately, AIG went down, and the American taxpayers paid $180 billion for that rescue. You'll read about how at Fannie Mae, they ramped up their investments in risky mortgage securities in 2005, 2006, 2007, as the market was peaking in a search for bigger market share, profits, and bonuses for their executives. And you'll read about how Merrill Lynch, the executives, were unaware that they had built up a $55 billion exposure to subprime mortgages, an exposure that ultimately cost that company in 2007 over $20 billion in losses. Fourth, we detail the excessive borrowing, risky investments, and lack of transparency that combined to put our financial system on a collision course with catastrophe. On a system-wide basis, we had allowed to develop in this country over the last 30 years a shadow banking system, lightly, if regulated at all, that by the beginning of 2008 was bigger than the regulated commercial bank and thrift system in this country. $13 trillion of assets in dark markets versus $11 trillion in our commercially regulated banking system. And this shadow banking system, in many respects, had many of the characteristics of the system that led to panic after panic bank runs throughout the 19th century before the reforms of the Federal Reserve, as well as federal deposit insurance. We saw an explosion, as I said, in derivatives. And at firms itself, we saw excess risk and speculation and enormous leverage. Each of the major investment banks, for every dollar of capital, would be borrowing $30 to $40. A great example is Bear Stearns. Bear Stearns, at the end of 2007, had $11 billion in equity. They had $380 billion plus in liabilities. Every night, they would borrow $70 billion that would be due the next day. Think about it. It's like a small business that had $50,000 in equity, is borrowing $1.6 million, and has $300,000 due each and every day. The risk was enormous and outsized, and we paid the price. Fifth, we concluded that key policymakers at the Department of Treasury, the Federal Reserve, and the Federal Reserve Bank of New York were ill-prepared when this crisis hit, and that their inconsistent responses added to the uncertainty and the panic. And this was perhaps one of the most troubling findings. What had happened is it was clear that our financial system had outraced the public bulwarks and the public protections that existed to protect all of us and our economy. And it was clear that as this crisis broke out, as this infection spread, the people we wanted to depend upon to contain it did not have a clear understanding of the financial system that they were entrusted to oversee. As the crisis broke out, they scrambled as each new front opened. They were on a battlefield where they were fighting blindly. They scrambled, they put fingers in the dike, they had no plan for containment because they did not fully understand the system they were supposed to regulate. So you will see in our report instances throughout 2007 where regulators and policymakers believed the subprime crisis will be contained, and of course we know it was not. One of the most striking things you'll see in this report is that it's only a month before Lehman Brothers collapse that the Federal Reserve Bank of New York is seeking information about Lehman's 900,000 derivatives contracts with other financial institutions to try to understand what would happen if Lehman went down. And sixth and finally, we documented systemic breaches in accountability and ethics at all levels during the run-up to the crisis. Yes, borrowers who took out loans they never should have taken out or had no intention of paying on. Lenders and mortgage brokers who steered borrowers into high-cost loans. Firms like Countrywide that made loans to borrowers that they knew they could not afford. From 1996 to 2005, the number of suspicious activities reports on mortgage fraud, these are reports about potential financial crimes filed by financial institutions, grew 20-fold, doubled again between 2005 and 2009. A study which we reviewed indicated that between 2005 and 2007, there were $1 trillion worth of loans made in this country, mortgage loans with proven fraud that have resulted in $112 billion in losses. And we found striking new evidence that financial firms bought and packaged securities consisting of millions of mortgages that they knew to be defective, and they never disclosed those facts. In our report, we outlined specific firms and individuals who acted irresponsibly. And let me be clear about one thing. Not everyone participated in these excesses, but this was not caused by just a few bad actors. Ultimately, as a commission, we place responsibility with the public leaders charged with protecting our financial system and the chief executives of the companies whose failures drove the crisis, because these were the people who sought and accepted the responsibility of leadership. We wrote this report for the American people, and I hope that you will read it, because we want as many people to read this, because we believe deeply that if we do not learn from history, we are unlikely to fully recover from it. I hope when you wade into its pages, you'll find it interesting, provocative analysis, fascinating details, and compelling stories you have not come across before. Our report is more than a book. We have a terrific website, fcic.gov, which is going to be housed for at least the next 25 years at Stanford Law School. On that website, you'll find 2,000 documents. You'll find audios, transcripts, and more than 300 witness interviews. You'll find additional staff reports and data, because our goal was to create an enduring historical record of this crisis. And the public is interested. Since we released our report, more than 500,000 people have visited this website, nearly 1.2 million page visits. And strikingly, for a report that is available online for free, this report has been on the New York Times and Washington Post bestsellers list. It speaks to me to the intense interest and hunger of Americans to understand what happened and how we find ourselves in such dire circumstances today. I've just set out for you what we did on our report and what we found. Now the question is, where are we today and what do we do in the wake of this disaster to move our country forward? And this is the first time I've really spoken on this subject, because for the last year and a half, I have been looking backward. It's time for us to continue to understand, learn and understand what happened, but begin to think about the ramifications for the future of this country. And I want to be clear, this report should not be the end of the nation's examination of this crisis. We had a budget of $9.8 million. I guarantee you I know of one law firm that billed its bank clients more than our entire budget. The fact is that we had a small budget, a dedicated team. We found new information, new facts, but my view is there is still much to learn, much to investigate, and much to fix. And in many respects, our financial system is still unchanged from what existed on the eve of the crisis. Indeed, today, more power is concentrated in fewer and bigger banks than ever before. By the end of 2009, according to the New York State Comptroller, financial industry profits reached triple the level of 2006. And Wall Street's unique law of gravity is back in full force. After the crash, total compensation and benefits at publicly traded Wall Street banks and security firms hit a record $135 billion in 2010. Most disturbingly, there seems to be almost no correlation between who drove this country to crisis and who is paying the price for the disaster. and very little consequence for those who are most responsible for this crisis. It's as if we had a devastating earthquake that left the gleaming skyscrapers at the epicenter untouched while rubble was strewn everywhere else. And many hardworking people rightly wonder who will help them dig out. Yet stunningly, as we meet tonight, we are now seeing strong pushback from the financial industry and their political allies in Washington, D.C. Complaints from bankers that they're being regulated too tightly. We're seeing efforts to undermine the Dodd-Frank financial reform bill, which is a strong and good bill that will help us avoid another crisis. Just 2 weeks ago, the House of Representatives' new Republican majority voted to cut the budget of the Securities and Exchange Commission, which I might add is a fraction of the size of the bonus pool of just one major investment bank. And despite the fact that the agency brings in more in fees and fines than its budget, they also voted to cut the budget of the Commodity Future Trading Commission, which is charged with a Herculean task of reforming and bringing into the sunshine this giant derivatives markets. But perhaps most perniciously, there is now an attempt to revise history about what brought us to where we are today. They don't want to change the rules, so they are trying to change the subject. We now see efforts to blame working people, teachers, firefighters, janitors, and their pensions for our fiscal woes, and we see efforts to wipe away the history of what brought us here. Here's the real story from my perspective. Yes, there have been instances of pension excess and budgetary irresponsibility, but let's be clear on the facts about what did and did not cause this crisis. And I want to say right here and right now that teachers and their pensions did not bring us to our knees. The average salary in the nation for teachers is approximately $50,000, less than the most junior analysts on Wall Street. Here in California, the median teacher retirement stipend to those people who taught our children is $2,400 a month with no Social Security. And the California budget, I think, is instructive. It was clear to me that the state was living beyond its means before the crisis. As treasurer, I opposed budgets to spend $8 to $10 billion more than we were bringing in. I campaigned on that basis, highly successfully, I might add, as for governor in 2006. But the real culprit behind California's $26 billion budget shortfall today is the fact that we have this enormous fallout from Wall Street excess. Because of job losses and the economic slowdown, states' revenues for the upcoming budget year are $41 billion below what they were projected to be before the economy collapsed. There are people on Wall Street and in Washington who are betting that the real story of our financial downfall will be buried in the confusion and conflict that reigns today. But I am betting they are wrong and that the truth will prevail. In the face of all this, there's much anger in this country, and justifiably so. I must confess, I was shocked and angry at what I've seen and learned. But anger is not a policy prescription. So the question is, where do we go from here? And I'd like to offer four thoughts on this subject. First of all, I want to talk about the matter of justice. The most frequently asked question I get is, where are the prosecutions for wrongdoing? Why has no one paid a price? There's a sense that there's a different standard of justice for those of wealth and power than for other people in this country. And this is particularly striking in light of the fact that in the wake of the S&L crisis, there were more than 1,000 felony convictions of bank and S&L executives. And when you look at some of the settlements with those who were charged in civil cases, it's appalling. People made away with tens and hundreds and billions of dollars, settling for pennies on the dollar with no admission of wrongdoing. Many Americans are paying more in parking tickets than are being paid by the people on Wall Street who drove us to where we are today. Now, I'm not a lawyer. We were not appointed to be prosecutors. But I want to say we did our job. We laid out the facts. Other bodies like the Senate Subcommittee on Permanent Investigations have done the same. We've opened the door with the facts, and now prosecutors and regulators need to walk through that door and do theirs. And this is important. It's not about vengeance. We don't want hangman justice in the United States of America. It's about fairness and deterrence so it doesn't happen again. I guarantee you, if someone robbed a 7-Eleven and took $500 and the next day was able to settle for $50 with no admission of wrongdoing, they'd be knocking over the same store the next night. Secondly, the new law that was passed last year by the Congress, signed by the President, must be enforced and fully implemented. and there are efforts now to undermine that. We need stronger regulation. We need to make sure that there is not excess at the very heart of our economy in the financial sector. And we need to stay vigilant because the financial sector is constantly evolving, and it will continue to evolve. The firms on Wall Street are like greased pigs. They're hard to chase down, and they're hard to catch, and they're always moving. So what we need are regulators with backbone and political will. And we need a Congress that's doing the right kind of oversight, making sure regulators are doing their job, not trying to stop them from doing their job. Thirdly, and this is apropos given the nature of this series, we need a new sense of corporate responsibility in America. We need a financial sector that engages in some self-reflection. I will tell you, I saw little or none of that in our hearings and investigation, and I think that's because the financial sector was spared the consequences of their action when the federal government waded in, not just with TARP, the $700 billion bailout, but 24 separate programs to ballast that industry and those firms in which the taxpayers committed trillions of dollars. So we need self-reflection because ultimately the soundness and sustained prosperity of our economy rely on notions of fair dealing and responsibility. We should always strive to have an economy where businesses are profitable at the same time they produce products and services of quality and conduct themselves well. And finally, and most importantly, we need to dedicate ourselves to building an economy of sustained strength and broadly shared prosperity again in this country. Here, to me, is the greatest tragedy of the last decade in the United States. We squandered so much low-priced capital and foreign investment that flowed into this country. What did we do with it? We created trillions of dollars of phony securities instead of applying that capital to building jobs, enterprises, and wealth. And I wholeheartedly disagree with those who said this was caused by a credit bubble. Available capital can be a boon to a society if it's applied well. And tragically, what do? We built a sandcastle economy that was swept out with a wave, and now we have nothing to show for it. Increasingly, our economy became an economy that was about money making money, not money making things of value. The financial sector represented about 15% of corporate profits in 1980. By the early 2000s, the financial sector represented over 30% of the corporate profits in this country. We became a country that valued big bets rather than a country that bet on value. To produce a vibrant economy, we have to export something that the world wants beyond just financial engineering of investment banks, clever ways to disguise debt, and no loose securities laced with risk. It's time that we join the rest of the world in pursuing the American dream of real economic prosperity. So in conclusion, let me say this. I do not believe that the story of this financial crisis is finished. All over this country, people continue to suffer. The foreclosure crisis goes on. We, as the citizens of this great country, have the chance to write the final chapter. It is in our hands. It now falls to us to make different choices if we want different results. Thank you very much, and I look forward to your questions.
Our thanks for your remarks this evening, and it's now time to hear from the audience. So let me begin, and your comment that the question you've been asked the most relates to the prosecution of people who were involved in the crisis, and that was certainly supported by the questions that came out of the audience here. And in fact, the leadoff question is from Charles Ferguson, who appeared last night. He's the filmmaker who made Inside Job, and he wanted to know why, if it's true, you aren't advocating yourself more aggressively for people to be put in jail, and why the commission didn't use the subpoena power more aggressively to bring people
Great.
In.
So let me talk about both of those. Well, so first of all, as I said, we weren't appointed as prosecutors, but we had a legal obligation to refer any potential violations to the appropriate authorities. Where we found that information, we did our job. I have a lot of respect for our judicial system, so clearly it's not appropriate to talk about cases that might be under investigation. People are do their day in court, but I've been very clear in my remarks tonight that there needs to be justice, there needs to be follow-up. There's a great sense in this country that there has been wrongdoing and it needs to be fully investigated. And so I have spoken very clearly on this and will continue to do it. Also, with regard to the subpoena power, let me talk about this. We reviewed millions of pages of document. The power of the subpoena is that you have it, not that you need to use it. Because if you have it, they know you can use it. And in most instances, companies who want to avoid bad publicity complied with our requests. But we did use it. The 9/11 Commission had subpoena authority. They used it 3 times. I believe we used it 19 times. But we came right to the threshold many times. We'd tell people we want X, they give us Y. We'd say, no, we want X, they give us Z. We say, we're going to issue a subpoena. They say, go ahead. We said, okay, it's being written right now. They say, okay, we'll give you what you wanted. So we went through that. But in the end, we issued a number of subpoenas to Goldman Sachs, to Moody's, to Warren Buffett, I might add, to a whole number of people to compel both production of documents as well as to produce testimony.
Thank you. Another question that Mr. Ferguson asked last night was whether the commission's report would, in his words, go nowhere because you had a partisan split in the commission itself. Could you talk about how that came about and what you think the implications of that partisan split will be for the credibility and acceptability of your report?
I have a couple of comments on this. I mean, the first is I'll let the people make their judgment. What we've done in this report, the bulk of this report, is really our findings of fact. What's really remarkable is that now some 4 weeks plus after this report has been released, there's been no challenge issued to the veracity and the accuracy of the facts in here. We've laid out a history of what happened in this country from 1980, and we chart very intensively the crisis through 2007 and 8. So there's been no challenge to the facts, and so I'll stand on those facts. I believe the report has power because it's truthful, and I believe our conclusions have power because they're truthful. As to the dissents, I'll let people read those and see whether they're supported by the facts. I know that the 6 commissioners, 5 Democrats and 1 independent, who signed this report, spent the year, looked at the facts, and drew our conclusions from that. Washington's a tough town, and we're now in a period of our country where sometimes there's memos that go out just say, vote no. I can't tell you if that happened on this commission, but I will tell you, for those of us who signed this report, we took our work seriously. We had a diverse group of commissioners, corporate CEO, as I mentioned, John Thompson, a woman named Heather Murren, who was appointed by Harry Reid, who was one of the most respected equity analysts on Wall Street, who knew the street and understood it. We had Brooksley Bourne on the commission, who knew the financial markets extraordinarily well. So I think the ultimate judgment will be, is it factual? Is it truthful? And will it stand the test of time? And I believe it will. And I'll leave it to you to make your own judgment when you read this report.
One follow-up question that I got from a number of the members of our audience is how you felt about the resources that you were allocated. One of the questions, and I don't know if it's totally accurate, but says that the Monica Lewinsky investigation had 10 times the resources that you did. And what could you have done with additional resources if you'd had them?
Well, I'm frankly pleased that Chris Seifer worked 19 hours a day. That was helpful. Well, this is interesting. And one reason I think, as I said, we've opened a number of doors here. And there's a lot in this report that was not known before about what happened at AIG, about what happened between Goldman Sachs and AIG that helped set in motion a series of events that brought about the crisis. A lot that wasn't known about what happened at Citigroup and the kinds of risks they were taking and what their management knew or not knew. One very significant piece of information we found out is that there's a company called Clayton Holdings that was hired by all the big investment banks, whether it was Goldman or UBS or Deutsche Bank or Citigroup, to review the mortgages that they were buying from Countrywide and New Century and Ameriquest that they were buying and bundling and selling to investors. They would have this firm look at these loans, really, because when the lenders would come to them, the lenders would say, well, we'd like $100 for these loans. The banks would say, well, we've kind of looked at them. They're not that good. We'll only pay $80 or $90. But let me tell you what Clayton Holdings found. Clayton Holdings reviewed 2 to 5% of loan pools that were being purchased from January of 2006 to June of 2007. They found that 28% of the loans were defective, which means they didn't even meet the lousy underwriting standards of the subprime lenders that they were being made. That was the you can get a loan if you can fog a mirror period. 28% of the loans were clear failures. Despite that, they waived in or accepted 39% of the defective loans, and they never disclosed what they knew. Now, if they were sampling 2 to 5% of the loans, they looked at 911,000 loans. That means the loan pools were 20 to 40 million loans. This wasn't some rogue guy off to the side. It was pervasive. And we found many instances. Now, should the examination continue on issues like this? Absolutely. We had a budget of $9.8 million. I won't whine or complain, but let's put it in perspective. The examiner for Lehman Brothers in the bankruptcy spent $38 million examining one company. The Madoff trustee, who is now trying to make right for those people who were swindled by Bernie Madoff, has spent $200 million plus to date. We had a small budget, but we had passion for what we were doing, and I believe that what we've done here is provide a historical account and a roadmap for people who want to follow up on our work.
You're listening to the Commonwealth Club of California radio program, and our speaker today is Phil Angelides, chair of the Obama administration's Financial Crisis Inquiry Commission, who is discussing the commission's recently released report and its ramifications. Could you just look under the cover just a little bit for our audience and talk about the internal processes of your commission and what it was like to get to conclusions and then have the dissent split off? Is there anything else you can tell us about that process?
Well, let me talk about it in general terms. I think most people are really interested in what happened to our country, not the internecine discussions that might happen in a commission. But I will tell you that what we had was a very open process in which any commissioner could offer full comments on the report. Any commissioner could ask for areas to be investigated. And obviously, our limitation was, given our budget and our time, that we had to make judgments about what was truly important. Any commissioner could attend public hearings. And so we worked very hard to make sure every commissioner had every opportunity to participate. For whatever reasons, come December of last year, the four Republican commissioners decided to issue a preemptive dissent before the report was completed. So they did that. I will say from that date on, it was pretty clear we weren't going to get unanimity once that was put out publicly. Among the six of us who did sign this report, we worked, we learned from each other. It was very interactive. You had asked me, you know, before we came out here, you know, how did you put the conclusions together? As chairman, obviously, took a role, but commission. I learned a lot from my fellow commissioners. I learned a lot from John Thompson, who led a major corporation, and I learned a lot from Brooksley Bourne, who had a long history in financial regulation. So it was very interactive, and in the end of the day, as I said, I think we produced something of real value here for the American people. You know, this is different than the 9/11 Commission report where they got unanimity, because in that instance, what you had is you had an attack on the country. I think it was also a somewhat different time in the country, even though there was intense polarization at that time. I will say in this instance, you have internal divisions in the country about what happened, plus you also had very powerful financial interests who had a stake in what we would say. And that was always a constant presence. Not for me, not for the others who came down with, I think, some very firm conclusions here, but make no mistake about it, the financial industry watched what we did very carefully, had fleets of lawyers who were on us, you know, each and every day. At the end of the day, though, I think the six of us knew that our obligation was to the country and to the future.
Let me ask you a little bit about the dissents. One of the dissents points to Freddie Mac and Fannie Mae as the inciting factor in the bubble and the primary cause. The other dissent looks at 10 factors, which in many cases they say were of a more global source than just the United States, and that these 10 factors together led to the meltdown, and that it was hard in foresight to see this coming. And the factors, just briefly, of course, are the credit bubble, the housing bubble, non-traditional mortgages being developed, securitization of those mortgages, financial institutions concentrating risk, perhaps unconsciously to some extent, too much leverage with not enough capital behind it, the too big to fail rule, and then that it spread from the financial sector to the rest of the economy after a panic. So what would you say about that? Do you disagree with the facts there, or is it a conclusion that you differ with, or what would you say?
Well, let me actually take these one at a time. And that is, let me take the dissent that was filed by three members of the commission. And again, the Republicans were not able to agree among themselves on these issues. But if you look at the dissent, you'll see many areas of commonality. They point out the failures of the credit rating agencies. They point out the flaws in the mortgage securitization train. They acknowledge that mortgage fraud was a contributor, not primary causer, but of this crisis. They also say agreed with the six of us on issues like the Community Reinvestment Act not being a significant factor in this crisis. So if you look at the dissent by the three members, you will see many areas of common agreement, but we depart on two. The first is that they attribute no responsibility or accountability. And this goes back to our central finding. You know, aliens didn't do this to us. The Chinese did not make us take their capital and squander it. CEOs, corporations, people at trading desks made decisions. Regulators, policymakers made decisions. And many of these were very conscious. The decision to deregulate derivatives in 2000, after Brooksley Bourne had warned about the risks, was a very conscious policy decision. I might add, made on a bipartisan basis. The decision to erode the Glass-Steagall protections that were put in place after the Depression, eroded first by the Federal Reserve and then repealed in 1999, was a conscious policy decision. The Federal Reserve's decision not to constrain out-of-control subprime lending was a conscious decision. Alan Greenspan was clear on that. And I might add, you know, Alan Greenspan wasn't quiet and nefarious. He was very clear. He believed in unfettered markets. And many people accepted the notion that that markets would always self-correct. So we disagree on the notion of responsibility and accountability. We had a willingness to call it as it was, whether there was a Democrat or a Republican in power at the time the decision was made. Secondly, as to this notion that the credit bubble itself created the crisis, I reject that, and we reject that. Because if you know that there's a lot of money in the system, you know that people will be prone to take excess risk. So when you see banks levering themselves up 40 to 1, when you see Citigroup, that's a commercially regulated bank, with such off-balance sheet accounts that their real leverage, instead of being 16 to 1, in other words, $1 of capital for every $16 in assets, when you see it's 32 to 1, which means a 3% drop in their asset values wipes out the firm. In a credit bubble, you have to be especially conscious about risk. The fact is, we could have taken that low-priced capital and applied it in much better ways than creating $13 trillion of mortgage securities that resulted in the disaster we had.
Thank you. One of your conclusions was that many of the government. Sure, go ahead.
Just one thing. So as to the other dissent, let me tell you what we found as to Fannie and Freddie. And I might say that, again, the three members, I think, came close to agreement with us on this issue. We agreed that Fannie and Freddie did not cause the crisis, but they contributed. We found that their business model was deeply flawed. The notion of a profit-making, publicly traded corporation with the implicit and then explicit backing of the U.S. government, which turned out to be the model, by the way, for all Wall Street banks, where you privatize the gain and you socialize the loss, was a flawed model. We found many of the same corporate governance breakdowns that you found at Lehman and Bear Stearns and Citigroup. But the facts are that Fannie Mae and Freddie Mac did not lead the charge to the worst of the subprime lending. They followed and tried to catch up. They were losing market share. They wanted to regain market share, so in 2005, they started to engage in that rush for fool's gold and took enormous risks, and Chris Seifer and his team details it immensely. Now, did they add helium to the housing boom? Absolutely, but at no time did they represent a majority of the purchase of subprime securities. And here's two more facts for you. We did and again, with very little resources, a tremendous team, we put together an analysis of 25 million loans in this country. We looked at how they performed. The loans that were packaged, securitized by Wall Street and other private firms, those that were packaged and securitized by Freddie Mac, Fannie Mae, and those by FHA. When you take apples to apples, so take a borrower with a credit score of 660 or below, which doesn't necessarily mean they're subprime, but take that pool of borrowers. Among that pool of borrowers, the default rates by the end of 2008 for the loans securitized and purchased and created by Wall Street and other financial firms other than Fannie and Freddie, the default rate was 28%. For the similar pool of borrowers, for those loans that were guaranteed or purchased by Fannie Mae and Freddie Mac, it was 6%. I mean, they performed measurably better. And the final point I'd make is this. From 2007, January of 2007, all the way up to the day before Fannie and Freddie were put into conservancy, their GSE-backed securities never lost value in the market. They didn't create the big losses on Wall Street. They were created by the private label, Wall Street created mortgage securities. Now, look, Fannie and Freddie were big, they made tremendous mistakes, and they've stuck us with a big bill. They are desperately in need of reform, but they were not the center of this crisis.
You know, one of the conclusions you reach is that our government and the responsible individuals in the Federal Reserve were not up to the task. And I guess I've got a couple of questions on them. I guess the fundamental question is, why was that? Why did we have people that weren't up to the task in these important jobs?
Well, I think there were a couple of reasons. I think there was a belief that had set in, certainly not embraced by everyone, but you know, really from 1980 on, there was an increasing belief that markets could regulate themselves. And of course, you don't want regulation that stifles innovation, even though I will challenge the notion that these new securities, this financial engineering, was innovation. I think it was Paul Volcker who said the last real innovation in the financial sector was the ATM. John Thompson actually observed it was the loan, which was dates back several thousand years. But there was a deep belief that models had been developed to calibrate and control risk, that institutions' instincts for self-preservation equaled their survival and therefore the protection of the public interest. And so what you had was you had a belief in this system. You also had growth of this financial services industry without the regulatory framework evolving. So as I said, by the time you get to 2008, this shadow banking system, commercial paper, something called the repo market, which was an overnight lending market that was $2.8 trillion in size. By the beginning of 2008, the lightly regulated shadow banking system is now bigger than our regulated system. They didn't have the information. As I said, a month before Lehman goes down, the Federal Reserve scrambling to say, okay, if Lehman goes down, they have 900,000 derivatives contracts with other financial institutions. Who's going to get hurt? They don't know. They're flying blind. There were dark markets, no transparency. Now, some of those who oppose regulation say, well, what we need is more transparency, but you need regulations to require transparency to have transparency. And what we had was a set of policymakers who were flying blind and who accepted on too much faith that private corporations, their interests were synonymous with the public interest. And by the way, the history here, if you look at it, shows that every time a major bank with systemic consequences would get in trouble, the U.S. government would ride to its rescue, whether it was First Franklin in the 70s or Continental Illinois in the 80s or a slew of banks in the late 80s and 90s or late 80s. They didn't ride to the rescue of Lehman Brothers. But normally, the rule has been, if there's a bank with systemic consequences, we're going to save them.
There were a number of questions on this topic, and also I saw quite a bit of commentary on this in various press reactions to the report, but the concept is that we've always had bubbles in human history. And in your report, you conclude that this was avoidable, that we could have seen it coming, and yet there have been so many bubbles, and it seems almost to be a part of human nature to want to get on the bandwagon with the bubble and ride it up and then, of course, crash down. What do you think about that?
Well, I mean, first of all, let me talk about human nature first. Is there greed? Yes. Is there avarice? Yes. Is there hubris? Yes. To say they were the cause of the crisis is too simple. It was our failure to account for those human characteristics that brought us to this point. But here's, I think, where the commission's conclusions depart with people who make those observations, which is that I don't think we need to consign ourselves to a fate that this will always happen. It need not happen. There are instances in which societies act prudently to ward off this kind of cataclysm, and this country did a pretty darn good job of it for 7 decades and then lost its compass and its sense of history. We do not believe, and we say it in the report, that you can repeal the business cycle, but we also don't believe we are fated to a condition where 27 million people are out of work, 13 million people may lose their homes. You know, one of the things that's interesting is one of my fellow commissioners sent me the other day the preface to Ferdinand Pecora's book. He was the investigator in the 1930s who unveiled much of what had happened in the stock market manipulations of the 20s and the crash. And it's so interesting to read what he said in his preface, because I just want to read this, and it's apropos of what we're seeing now, this kind of revisionism that who could have seen it coming, these things just happen. He said, frequently we are told, he writes this in 1939, he says, frequently we are told that this regulation has been throttling the country's prosperity. Bitterly hostile was Wall Street to the enactment of the regulatory legislation. It now looks forward to the day when it shall, as it hopes, reassume the reins of its former power. The public, however, is sometimes forgetful. As its memory of the unhappy market collapse of 1929 becomes blurred, it may lend at least one ear to the persuasive voices of the streets subtly pleading for a return to the good old times. After 5 short years, we may now need to be reminded what Wall Street was like before Uncle Sam stationed a policeman at its corner, lest in time to come some attempt be made to abolish that post. And so my view is our most important work here is to lay out what happened so we are less likely to repeat this mistake in the near future. Thankfully, the New Deal reforms in the 1930s warded off this kind of catastrophe for our country for 7 decades. We need to be as aggressive in trying to do it again. It can be done. And I'm very concerned now that few lessons have been learned. There's a push to go back to business as usual. As I said, there's a pushback happening to try to rewrite the history of this, and I think it will be extraordinarily damaging to this country.
You know, you mentioned in your remarks that not everyone was involved, and then, of course, you do name names with respect to a lot of the individuals and institutions that you feel were responsible. Did you come across any uplifting good actors in this investigation? Is there anything positive that you could tell us?
So first of all, let me say, yeah, we came across people who worked in the financial sector who did the right thing. In fact, you know, one of the most famous deals around is the deal on which the Securities and Exchange Commission sued Goldman Sachs. It's the Abacus 2004. 2007 is one of the Abacus deals where they essentially sued Goldman on the basis that they bet against a set of securities that they helped stack and create for failure. You know, that deal or that essential structure was brought to a couple people at Bear Stearns who rejected it, didn't feel it was the right thing. We ran into a lot of people in this country, homeowners, who had done everything right. They hadn't taken the crazy loan. They had 20% down. They lived in places like Nevada where now 70%+ of the homes with mortgages are underwater. They lost their jobs and therefore they lost their homes. We met a woman in Bakersfield who had always worked throughout her whole life. In 2007, you know, had a dream to start an office supply business, but started it right at the time that the whole economy was beginning to shatter. She was paying $1,000 a month on her mortgage. She asked for and got a temporary modification for $775, made every one of those payments. For the next 18 months, she communicated with J.P. Morgan 87 times. They kept sending her these envelopes that say, J.P. Morgan, your house is your home. We want to keep you in it. And at the end of all that time, they informed her that they denied her permanent modification, and they were foreclosing on her. So we met a lot of people who did the right things, and I will just say that through the course of this, not everyone was involved in these excesses. Many people did choose the right path. You don't read about them because they're the ones who walked away from the deals.
Thank you. I have a number of questions.
Well, and let me ask, Brooksley Bourne did the right thing. I think Sheila Bair, I want to say this, at the FDIC in the early 2000s, tried to put together some industry best practices on subprime lending with a guy named Ned Gramlich, who was on the Federal Reserve Board, but they couldn't get the political muscle together to do it. There were people in public positions who tried to step forward and do the right thing, and they're cataloged in this book. And many, I'll just add, many states did the right thing. One of the, I think, most tragic things that happened is in the late 90s, early 2000s, the states were aggressively pursuing predatory lending practices. And the Office of the Comptroller of the Currency and the Office of Thrift Supervision came in 2003 and preempted state any efforts by the state to control nationally chartered banks and thrifts, saying, you know, it's going to cause too much confusion, harm for 50 states to be regulating national banks and thrifts. Well, what the national regulators should have done is join hands with the state regulators and go after the state-regulated and national banks together. So there's Lisa Madigan in Illinois, who is the attorney general. Good, thoughtful, aggressive, did good work. I might add, and I just want to say, I was talking to her the other day, Congresswoman Jackie Speer, who comes from near here, just south of here, San Mateo, fought a very tough battle in the early 2000s to adopt a fair lending law here that was challenged by the federal government and by all the big banks. So there were people out there, and they're cataloging this book, who are trying to do the right thing.
You know, we're reaching the point in our program where there's time for only one last question, and it's a big one. And okay. I got it from a number of people in the audience. It really has to do with the future. We had questions about, should Glass-Steagall be reinstituted? Is Dodd-Frank enough? I guess the question for you is, if you were the czar of all this going forward, based on everything you've seen and your very extensive experience in California at the federal level, what would you do and what do you think is going to happen to us?
So first of all, I'm very concerned about what's going to happen to us, both on the economic front where I worry about the fragility of the economy. You know, I'm concerned. I hope that we're not repeating in Washington now in 1937 where our momentum out of the Great Depression was hurt when budget cuts began to destabilize an economy. But in terms of financial reform, I believe the Dodd-Frank legislation is a good, strong piece of legislation and needs to be implemented. I do believe that we have to be constantly vigilant about the size and concentration of financial power in this country, which requires that we have particularly tough and ongoing vigilant scrutiny of the largest financial institutions. One of the issues I raised with Federal Reserve Chairman Ben Bernanke, who I will say I think among all the policymakers that we came across has owned more of his mistakes than the Federal Reserve's mistakes, and he worked very well with us because he himself is a student of history and was interested in history being written, is that there is a mismatch here where it's tough to attract and keep people in public service, and what we need to do is not just have the right kind of oversight to make sure regulators are doing the right thing, but we need to give them the resources, the salaries, the wherewithal to have the skills to be able to know what's going on in the financial sector. It's very tough to attract people to the public service, keep them there, to watch over these financial behemoths, and I think one of our greatest challenges is to empower the people we want to help protect our system. But we are at risk, and we are always at risk.
Oh, I'm so excited. We have 1 minute left, so I want you to just give us your best shot on what we ought to do in California to save ourselves.
Well, you had your chance. No, I'm just kidding. Look, I I will tell you, after my year and a half in Washington, there's no doubt I will live the rest of my life in California. Look, I believe Jerry Brown's trying to do the right thing here, which is we gotta staunch the bleeding. We gotta balance the budget. There was a great window of opportunity to do that in the early 2000s. We need to do it. The legislature needs to do it and get it to the ballot. The people need to approve a measure to balance this budget that's fair, that has some revenues, that allows us to sustain basic services so we can start building again. We've spent a decade treading water and going backward because of an inability to reconcile what we want in the way of services and investments and what we're willing to pay. So I wish the governor all the best, and I think he's off to a good start, so let's help him succeed.
Our thanks to Phil Angelides, chair of the Obama administration's Financial Crisis Inquiry Commission and former California State Treasurer. We also thank our audiences here and on radio, television, and the internet. We also want to remind you that copies of the Financial Crisis Inquiry Report are on sale outside this room, and that Mr. Angelides will be pleased to sign copies of the report immediately following the program. And I'm Mary Cranston, and now this meeting of the Commonwealth Club of California, the place where you are in the know, is adjourned.
Thank you. Thank you.